Good evening. I'd like to welcome you all to our service tonight. And especially if there's anybody visiting with us, then we give you a special warm welcome. And we hope that you've been yourself known at the door and you've had a nice welcome from the people there. And we hope that you'll feel very much at home. Tonight we have a special evening where Peter and Leslie, two of our members, are going to be telling us all about the Centre of Hope from GLIA, which is the charity God's Love in Action that they started in Romania 20 years ago just now. And I was just speaking to them there to see how many more sections of 20 years that they're hoping to see. So they said another two that would suit them. But no, we're very thankful for all the work that's being done in that area in the Lord's name and the many people whose lives have been touched and have been changed. And also, especially during this recent situation with the war in Ukraine, there is a lot more people who have come through the centre and have had their lives changed as well. And we just ask that the seeds that are sown to these people, that they will come to fruition in the Lord's time himself. Just one other thing is just to bring to your attention was the rescheduled Celtic worship, and to remember that it's on the 21st of June, and anybody who's not got a ticket yet or didn't get a ticket from the previous time, if you speak to Dennis, I'm sure he'll advise you or point you to somewhere. we're now just going to have a word of prayer. Father, we do thank you that we live in this area. We do thank you that where you have placed us, we thank you that you have brought people from many different locations and parts of the country to this church here in Lossiemouth. And we know that that is not for nothing. We know that you will use us in a mighty way as a collective in your name. And Father, we just pray that you will indeed lead us, you would fill us with your spirit, and you would surround us with your love, that we would know your will for us in this church, and especially in the community round about us. Father, we pray to thank you for the many blessings that you have bestowed upon us over the years, and we look forward to how we can serve you and how we can honour you in the days to come, whatever number that may be. So, Father, we especially pray you would be with Peter and Leslie tonight as they come up to speak to us. And we just pray that you would give them clarity of word and boldness to speak the words that you have put in their hearts. So, Father, just be with each and every one of us now as we continue in your name. Amen.
Let's stand and sing together before we hear from Peter. That'd be great.
Holy, oh, holy, Here I am with my assistant. Well, the boss. Anyway, good evening, everybody. And it's great to just have this opportunity to sort of bring you a bit up to date with the last 20 years in of the centre. But I want to start by reading Psalm 46. If you can turn to Psalm 46, I'm afraid I'm not as well prepared as some, and I can't give you the page number in the Bibles, but it's in roughly in the middle. Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. This past week, in fact, last weekend, marked 20 years since we actually opened the centre. So the story started of 2 or 3 years before that, but of the centre, that is. But I want to start by focusing on what has been our latest sort of happening at the centre, which is having the Ukraine refugees coming over. And we've been preparing for this, in actual fact, from early December, when we could see perhaps that things were getting a little bit tense out there, and there was a build-up of soldiers on the Ukraine, Belarus and Russian border. And at the beginning of March, we started to welcome Ukraine refugees. Although the Romania refugee Ukraine border is only 15 miles from the centre, most of those who came to the centre came through the Moldova into Romania, which is, again, only about 15 miles from the centre. During the following month or so, we received over 175, and this is just a few. Just a few of those, obviously not 175 on there, but just a few of those that we received. And they were picked up at the border by Sammy, who's the pastor at the Baptist Church in Dorohoi. And you may remember we've talked before about Raluca, who works for us. She's a social assistant. That's her husband. And he's got a contact, a Moldovan pastor, at the border area, so they were linking in, and when refugees were ready to be brought across, Sammy would go and get them, and also Catalina, another member of the church there. Many of them stayed only a few. Most of them stayed either one night or up to about four nights, but we did have a couple that only stayed a few hours. One was going to Israel, and one was going to Canada, but they just stayed long enough to have a meal, a shower, and for one of them feed a baby, and so on, before they continued on their journey. The majority of them spent many days crossing the Ukraine. Most of them came down from Kharkiv or Kyiv areas, and for many of them it was a several day journey, and for some of them it could take 2-3 days to actually get across the border into Romania. And the refugees were staying on the top floor of the annex, where we can accommodate about 18 people, and we provided them with showers, meals. There was a playground for the children and basic cooking facilities. But above all, it was somewhere to rest and find peace. And we had the opportunity of giving them a shoulder to cry on, as they were very distressed, and many had left elderly relatives behind. Most of the elderly chose to actually stay in the Ukraine. But it gave us a chance to talk through things with them. Most of them had some English, and those that didn't have much, we thank God for Google, which meant we could talk. I mean, I don't know whether you've ever seen Ukraine. It is a nightmare to even work out what words are, but we were able to talk to some of them in English, and in some cases we had the opportunity to talk about God and Jesus, and we had some Ukraine testaments, and I'm hoping that's going to change. Yeah, there we are. We were able to give out Ukraine testaments and children's Bibles and so on, and which many of them took with them, and many asked us to pray with them and pray for them. But all of those that came were understandably very distressed, and we would sit and talk to them, and some we were able to talk in greater depth. So Leslie's going to just tell us three stories of three families that came to the centre. Oh. Yeah.
I'm not giving the names, just in case some of them are now in the UK. So this was a son and daughter, a son and his mum came, and he's 12, and he learnt some English at school. So, but they arrived at the centre with three others after a very uncomfortable journey from Kharkiv. The mother was in a lot of pain with her leg, but after we helped her into the annex, her leg improved. They'd left her husband in Kharkiv, as so many that came to us had to do. Their house was still okay at the time of their arrival, but obviously distressed at the situation. The son spoke very good English and had clearly taken up the role of the man in the family. They stayed with us for 3 nights, and mother insisted that she wanted to work, so took on the cleaning of the annex. They were unclear to start with where they wanted to go, but eventually wanted to go to Germany. So we took them to a hotel in a neighbouring town where they were able to register for the free bus to Germany and other documentation. They are now settling down, and the son is in the local football team and has started school, and mum helps with other refugees. The next one is a wife, and a man came with his wife and disabled son late at night after a journey that had taken several days from Kharkiv. The following morning, I asked if he had had a good night's rest, and he said, "Wonderful night, no bombs, no shelling, no planes." As we were chatting after they'd had their breakfast, his wife asked if the sign in the dining room was Jesus. This sign was made for us out of nuts, bolts, and washers. She went on to say that they had prayed for God to provide a miracle, and the centre was the answer to that prayer, and that she was sure that we were Christians. She went on to explain that she is a Baptist, or Pentecostal Baptist, whatever that is. They had lost their house, the husband had lost his transport business. Their house had been destroyed, and when asked, they said they had nothing to go back for. We know that they originally were going to Poland, but they're now in Germany. Yeah. This is a young family, arrived again in the middle of the night. Their son, who is 15 months old, has cerebral palsy, and they were concerned that they find somewhere where they can continue with his therapy and treatment. And after many discussions, it was agreed that Germany would be the best place for them. They came from a village outside of Kiev, and when the Russian soldiers came down the street, they went down into their cellar. The soldiers entered their house, looted and destroyed their property, and then set fire to the house, trashed their car as well. We took them to the nearest station where they could start their journey to Germany. And when we arrived, some university student volunteers took them under their wing, got their tickets and stayed with them and saw them onto the train. They're now settled in an apartment in someone's house in Germany, and the father works from home, he's in IT, and the son is now receiving the therapy and treatment that he needs.
Right, thank you. Through all of this, the refugees remarked, and how there just seemed to be an aura of peace at the centre, and we've been able to tell them that it's God's peace, his refuge, and that he is present at the centre. Just to go back now to the centre, if we can go on to the next slide, please. This is the story of the centre actually started in 1999 when we felt God was calling us to, rather than just sort of taking aid out every sort of 2 or 3 times a year, to actually spend more time out there and to reach out to people. And the vision was that there would be a place where they could come out of their drab existence and so on. And we spent a lot of time looking at properties, and there was a nice Romanian man, in fact, the father of our centre manager, George. He was, every time we went, he said, "Don't say anything, I'll do the talking." And every time we went into a house, the price doubled. And every time we came out, he said, "Why don't you buy land and I'll build you a centre?" He was a builder, by the way. And so we did. We found some land. And when we were praying about this land, if we can just go back one, please. When we were praying about this land, someone sent this verse to us, not knowing what it was all about. and said, I just don't know what this is about, but we felt that this was the answer to prayer. The Lord your God will bless you in the land he is giving to you, which, and it was, it had been for sale for nearly 20 years. No one had been able to buy it. The people had wanted to put bars up and so on. But so we bought it and we built the center. And that was in, it was came to fruition round about the end of 2001. We were then equipping it, all sorts of stories about how God provided for us as we kept throwing down more and more fleeces about how we were going to equip it. But then we started to feel we were running out of space. So what we were, because everything was growing, seemed to be growing at a rate, and so we felt we needed an annex. So in 2010, we opened the annex. Again, an amazing story about how that was provided for. God provided the finance for the annex without us having to cut back on anything else at all. And it was just amazing. So here we are with in 2010 with two buildings. But going back again to the beginning, in the first year that we were there, the youth group from our church that we came from at that time wanted to do something for the community in our backyard. And that's what they built. They paid for and had transported out and came out and built this playground, which is and that was an amazing, amazing thing. It was the only playground in Dorohoy at that time. This is a town of 40,000 at that time. And it was just this wonderful opportunity to have children come together. And it was a terrific draw for children from all the different cultures in Romania. We had Gypsy children playing with Romanian children and so on. And there's those of you who know anything about Romania, there's a huge divide between the Romanians and the Gypsies. But here were children playing together. And then it went on, of course, and enabled us to start having a children's club. For one period at the children's club, we had over 90 children coming. It was a bit of a squash and it was a bit hot. And children, they're always encouraged to take their shoes off at the door. So there's a pile of 90 pairs of shoes at the door. But also, we've been able to have holiday clubs and children's events as well. Normally, for that sort of thing, we would get 200 children coming along to these events. In fact, one holiday club, we had over 400 children come. And I know it's a song that people don't particularly like, but they love our God is a great big God. And to go around Dorohoy after a children's club and hear children singing it in little corners and so on, it's just amazing. So we had the children sorted. We also needed to provide meals as well. And if we can go on, Brian. So when we started, we were doing... Well, the first time we said meals, we did 25 meals one day. And then we increased it to 3 days a week. And we were using a friend of ours who had been helping us with setting up the charity. And he had his own charity. And he said he would provide the people. And he came to us one Wednesday when we were having the meal, and he said, can you do another day's meal? Because I've got plenty of people. And I said, well, we'll pray about it. So we prayed about it on Wednesday night. We didn't really have a clear answer, but we had a certain peace. And we said, on the Thursday morning, we said, we'll do a Friday. We'll do a meal on Friday. I opened the emails, which was a lengthy process at that time. And there in there was an email from someone that was written the afternoon before saying, I've just put this sum of money. I don't know why, but God has told me to put this sum of money. And it was the exact sum of money needed for the extra day's meal for a year. God provides in amazing ways. So we started with averaging 40 meals in the older building. And then we moved on, there we are, and we were able to up it to 70. And then from there now, you can go to the next slide, this is how we've been doing it through the pandemic. We had to stop the sit-down meals, and we've been doing takeaways through the pandemic. And I just want to point out the girl on the, well, not the girl, the lady on the one that's saluting, on the left there, that's Ulrika. And she was brought up in the orphanage. She's 45, she's got TB. She's had a really rough time. We provide accommodation for her, pay for her to rent a room. And she is so grateful. When we were doing ordinary meals, sit-down meals, she would come in every day to clean the dining area, because she just was so grateful. She wanted to say thank you, and it's the only way that she could say thank you. So, and that's what we're doing at the moment. We're still doing takeaway meals, and we've yet to sort of work out how we're going to move on with that. So if we go on to the next slide, it's all about people. It's all about families. And I haven't got time here to go through lots of families, but this family is a family of seven children and a mum and dad. Now, when we first met them, which was a couple of two or three years before we even started opening the centre or thinking about the centre, it was just the mum and six children. Dad was in jail because he had to steal a bag of potatoes to feed his family. He had no work, and so he got six children to feed. He got 3 years in prison for that, and when he came out, from what he called the University of Life, he was determined that he would never go back there again. Now, this is a family that I'm just going to spend a little bit talking about, because it's quite a good success story, this one. When we were building the centre, Florin was his name, he'd been doing odd jobs. That's all the work that he could get. And when we built the centre, I insisted that he should be used at the centre. And George said, well, I don't know how much he knows, but he can always push a barrow around. Well, while he was involved building the annex, he learnt bricklaying, he learnt plastering, he learnt floor layings with concrete and so on. And when we'd finished, he was able to go and get a full-time job in a construction company. The children, we helped with schooling and with various training courses. They've all been to England. England is paved with gold. To all Romanians, it's paved with gold. But they've all been to England. Georgiana, the eldest one, she came to England. She married a boy, a Romanian lad from Dorohoi in England, and worked in a kebab shop. She now, this year, has opened a kebab shop in Dorohoi. And when we were out there, there were queues outside that kebab shop. But not only that, she's employing her two of her brothers to help her there. So things are getting better there. On our journey back, we were waiting in the local airport in the departure lounge, which is a dreadful place. But we were waiting there, and this young man came up to us and said, "Do you recognise me, Peter?" And I said, I was sort of taken aback, because, and he said, "I'm George." You see, and he said, "Alex." He used to like use the name Alex. He was a Chelsea supporter. Sorry, but he was a Chelsea supporter. And he introduced us to his wife and his child, and he was travelling back to England. We put him through a couple of training courses, and he came to England. He's now a fully qualified plumber, and he's now setting up a business of his own in Southend. So there's more. All of the children go back helping mum and dad. When we first met this family, they were in one room. They were renting two rooms. The second room had no floor, no ceiling, and the windows were broken. So they could only afford to live in one room. And we sort of renovated the second room. But now they've gone on. They've got a whole string of rooms and so on. So they now hardly come to the centre at all, other than to come and have a chat with us. So we can move on, which is always encouraging. These, I know you've seen these pictures before, these two guys before, but they again are special to us. They come every day. They were brought up in the orphanages, hugely huge mental problems that they've got. The one sitting hugging the radiator, he was living with horses. Those of you that may remember, he was living with horses. We've managed now to get him into a room and stay in a room. So he stays there at night and he lives at the centre during the day. Mutsa, the other one with the blue hat, we have tried, others have tried, he won't stay in a room. He just lives wherever he can, under a hedge, in pigsties, whatever. He just cannot settle into a room. And the only thing we can think of is that this fear of being reinstitutionalized. They feel if they go into a room, they're being institutionalized. But they're great guys, as are. But I think the backstory to that is that we never felt God calling us to work in the orphanages. But we now have 20 to 30 ex-orphans that come to us with varying types of psychological problems. Dear old Mutsa, he stands in the corner of our backyard talking to the neighbours' chickens. But not just that, he also recites poetry, sings hymns to them and so on, which is something he didn't do a few years ago, and it's gradually built up now. And Ovidiu, our centre manager, will quite often go out and sing hymns with him and join him that way, which is great. It's really lovely. So, moving on from there, if we can go back one, there we are. We also had various groups going. Again, they had to stop because of the pandemic. But we hope when we get back out there that we can sort of regenerate those and get them going again, and more. If we go to the next slide, it was important to us. When we first started, for about 3 years, we were, in a sense, building credibility, particularly with the churches. They were quite suspicious of us when we first went out there. And I was getting a bit frustrated because God didn't seem to be sort of doing much in the way of reaching out to the Romanians. We had people from groups in the UK coming out and going back and, you know, going back as having given their hearts to the Lord and being baptized, but nothing in Romania. So we started a Wednesday evening meeting. And when we were living out there for 7-8 years, I used to run that, but then every time we came back, it had to stop and so on. And then another brother of Ovidiu, who's a pastor in a village church, came to a baptism that we had there. And he said, I had no idea what you were doing here. He said, can I help? And I said, oh, you wouldn't like to do the Wednesday night meetings, would you? And he said, yeah, sure. So he now leads the Wednesday night Bible study and praise meeting. And to my mind, it's the best way to reach out is a Romanian reaching out to Romanian, because I used to have someone translating for me. And of course, again, another encouraging thing for us is, you know, through the pandemic, everything seemed to stop. But then we got news that two of our people were being baptized. There's Theodor standing in the middle. George is standing next to him. He's the builder. He's Ovidiu's dad, and Eugenie is next door to the other side, and that's Ovidiu's mum. Two wonderful Christians, two lovely Christians. They have so much pastoral work going on in their back garden and so on. And also Eugenie is excellent at making what they call gogosh, which are donuts. Really nice, hot donuts. And the other one is Emma, who is one of the girls that we've been helping to put through university. We've got lots of other things. Some of it is in that little leaflet that you were given as you came in. And always special for us is Christmas. If we can go to the last slide. And this, although we haven't been doing shoeboxes as such, this was about 3 years ago, a typical Christmas with all these children there with their shoeboxes and so on. About 200 of them we would be giving out. But then we were having difficulty getting shoeboxes, so we decided that we would put together gift bags. And in actual fact, the response to doing that has been so good that we not only give them to the children, we give them to everybody else. The elderly, the boys from the orphanages, the lads from the lassies from the orphanage, single people and so on. Everybody gets a food, gets a gift bag. And of course, we're able to put together dedicated gift bags. So make them rather, shoeboxes can sometimes be a little bit of a problem because you never know what's inside them. And sometimes they can be a disappointment, other times they're a great joy. But the kids love it. They get a word from Pastor Joseph, they sing carols, and then they get their shoebox. I'm really telling you that because the last 20 years has been nothing about us. Although we have sort of headed that, humanly we've headed it up, it's all about God and what he has done. He's provided in so many different ways. I could spend another couple of days telling you about what he's done. We are celebrating what God has done in the last 20 years. It's just been amazing, and his faithfulness has just been incredible. But I want to turn now, just briefly, to that passage and so on. And we may not be like Ukraine in fighting a war, and as in other places around this world of ours, fighting war with bombing, shelling and landmines and other terrible atrocities that we have been hearing about and we hear about in the news. But we are in a constant war with the devil. And we can take heart from the words of the psalm, whose psalmist who proclaims, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help. And you may remember that a few weeks ago we were made aware of what was called the Ukraine Psalm, Psalm 31, which we're told the Ukrainians were constantly repeating and starts with the words, in you, O Lord, I've taken refuge. And then in verse 14 it says, but I trust in you, O Lord. I say, you are my God. My times are in your hands. And knowing that God is our strength and refuge is something that it's very easy to say and believe when things are good. But this psalm says that he is our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. Even in our darkest, most difficult and chaotic times, we can know that he is present with us and we can take refuge in him and draw on his strength. There have been many occasions in the past 20 years at the centre when it felt as if we were being thrown a curveball. The state was making it difficult to operate or placing financial restrictions, or things just did not seem to be going well. There's a story I can tell you about someone called Carmen. We took she was a little gypsy girl, and she was, again, in dreadful situation, and we took her under our wing for about 11 years. And her mother used to take her out stealing because it was easier to get a child to go through the window and pinch stuff than it was for the adult to do it. And the whole family seemed to be involved in this. We took control of her schooling and so on and supported her through that and paid for her to go to school and things like that. And she used to come to church with us and so on and come to the Wednesday night meetings. But her mother one night insisted that she go and steal. And her mother went with her and she got caught. The mother managed to get away and she got caught. And her mother did nothing to defend her in any way or stand for her. And so she got sent to a youth detention centre. In Romania, these detention centres and prisons are not quite as soft as they are here. We used to go down and visit her and so on. And when she was due to come out, we found a place on the west side of one of the main towns as you enter into Romania called Oradea, where there was another charity run by an American that was taking in gypsy children, principally from orphanages. But we got a place for her, and they fell in love with her, much as we did. And one day she stole from one of the visitors, and it was the one thing that they didn't allow the children to stay for. She had to go away. They paid for her to go to somewhere else, and they paid for her to get a job and so on. But she wouldn't have this, and she slipped back into a pattern of stealing and so on. And well, we saw her, the last time we saw her was when we were out in March, and that's the first time in 3 or 4 years that we've seen her. And it's really sad. All we can hope is all that she heard and learnt from us about the Lord is still in her mind, and that she will realise that there is something special there, and that she needs to turn from her ways. But yeah, so we've had disappointments. Another one was, and I can't go into too much detail, but there was another young lady that we were helping. We'd helped her with her baby who had heart problems at birth, and we paid for her to have an operation, and that was a mammoth task to try and get anyone to deal with that, because she was a gypsy baby. But she had the operation, she went through the operation, she came out of it the other end, and she went for a checkup, and they put a breathing tube down her throat and pierced her artery, and she died. The mother, we helped with the funeral for that. Then later on, the mother's aunt, she was 25, something like that. The mother's aunt was getting very jealous, because she thought Brunusha was her name, was having an affair with her husband, which she wasn't, but she bought a can of petrol, she went into this girl's house, she doused her with petrol, set fire to her, and went out and locked the door. And so we had another funeral to deal with. We have many a time sort of had these sort of instances, and you say, why? When we think we're making progress and so on, why this? But we have learned over the years now that we can turn to God. Quite often when we go into a situation, we will pray about the situation before we go in and pray afterwards, that we get clear clarity as to how we can help. I can remember once going to one house, and there was just such a poor situation. It was so many needs there. And we came out and we said, we don't know how to deal with this. And we prayed about it, and it became very clear. God was saying, do what I'm asking you to do. The rest is my problem. And so we had a peace about that. And so knowing, even in our personal lives doing this, we have had issues at times where we've allowed the work to take over and so on. When we started, we used to open, people would be knocking on the door at 5, half past 5, and they'd still be knocking at the door at 10, 11 o'clock at night. And we felt we had to be open all that time. And we had one room in the centre. That was our bedroom, lounge and everything. It was just one room, and that was for 7 years. We had that because we felt we needed to be living how they lived, not with huge luxuries. But then someone said to us, you are no good to them if you go down the same route as them. And so we then had office hours. That was soon after we... that wasn't 7 years later. That was only 2 or 3 years later. One of the elders and one of the trustees of the charity came out and did an appraisal, and he said, you're burning yourselves out. But there were times when we did get things out of kilter personally and so on. But God has been patient with us, he's been faithful to us, and he's brought us through that. But in everything, we've had to trust God and talk to him and found that there is a peace despite the turmoil. And I'm sure we can all look back over our lives and at the difficult times and see how God has been there. Sometimes situations where perhaps at the time it was difficult to see where God was in that situation. We've had to react to situations, much as we've reacted to the Ukraine one. On the day that I moved us up from sunny Eastbourne, nice warm sunny Eastbourne, up to here, Leslie was gone out to Romania, and she arrived the day that I was moving us up, and Dorohoi had a flood. 250 homes were destroyed, and quite a few people were killed and drowned in that situation. But there was no one prepared to help. And Leslie, Ovidiu didn't know quite what to do, and Leslie said, first thing, we have a cup of tea. That's British, isn't it? We have a cup of tea, and they discussed it, and they managed to get food because people were pouring to the door, help us, you know, and they'd lost everything. You know, they were standing in their bare feet and so on. And so they went to the market and bought flip-flops for everybody. And I think he bought a load of underwear and so on for people, but also arranged for everyone to have pizzas and so on. And God has enabled us to react quickly in these situations. It took the town nearly 2 weeks to actually start to do something because they were in a state of shock. So that's one of the things that I think is great is that how we've been able to react react quickly to situations. But as God works in these situations, we're able to start to have a peace and knowledge that God is with us, and we can have a feeling of security and strength, knowing that we can face these situations because God is our strength. We're told that he gathers us under his wings as a hen does her chicks. And, well, I've seen that many a time. From my farming background, I've seen that many times. And there's a certain coziness about it. It's a place of warmth, place of safety, a place of protection that the mother hen gives to her chicks. When troubles come, when the ground seems to fall away from under us, we need something constant and true to hold on to. And the psalmist tells us not to fear because God is our refuge and strength and with us. And I love that verse from Isaiah 41 that says, I am the Lord your God who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you. I think it's got to be one of my favourite verses, that when we're facing difficult situations, that verse comes to my mind. God is with us. He's holding our hand, so he's got to be there. God is sovereign. He's in total control, and we can trust him and find comfort resting in him. This is the God of creation who controls everything. According to his plan, God is on his throne. He is our fortress, our protector. He is strong. We are reminded by the psalmist of all that he has done in the past. In verse 8, he says, come and see what the Lord has done, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars to cease and to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. All things to encourage us to put our trust in him and find our peace in him. And then it is as if God himself is speaking in the next verse where he says, be still and know I'm God. And I can remember, quite often we'll say quietly, be still and know that I'm God. But I wonder whether it's a be still and know that I'm God. Stop all our busyness. Just take time and appreciate God and see that he is going to be exalted among the nations. He is exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in all the earth. And this is a command to stop struggling and trying to do things on our own strength and just let God take up the battle. surely something we should all do, to take time to know God, and then we will get to know him better, and we will see that he is the great I am, that he is trustworthy, and he will be exalted by the nations and all the earth, and he is with us, dwelling within us, and we have an inner peace within our lives. When things are difficult, they may still be painful, but we can have the knowledge that God has promised that he will be with us and not abandon us. And in fact, he shows how much he is, it's his concern and love for us in sacrificing his son in order that we may have fellowship with him. Without the past, without the well, our sin prevents us from having fellowship, but God's sacrifice through his son enables us to come, be forgiven, and have our sins cast into the sea. And the more we have fellowship with him, the more we can come to see how much of a refuge he is and how much we can rely on his strength when the going gets tough. We know that there is going to be a time when God will put an end to all wars, wherever they are, and there will be justice. But in the meantime, we need to trust God and hang on to the inner peace that he gives us. Thank you.
We're just going to sing two songs now as we prepare to come to the communion table. We're going to sing "He Was Pierced" and then "Worthy Is the Lamb." Please stand and sing with us.
He was pierced for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities. And to bring us peace, he was punished. And by his stripes we are healed. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter.
Sheep have gone astray.
the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love.
Come now to the communion table. We invite all those who know and love the Lord as our Lord and Savior to come and join us here at this table, meaning it's an open table. If you don't know what that means, then we also say there's no embarrassment about letting these elements pass you by. But we've heard from Peter and Leslie as well, a little opening up from Psalm 46. And it's an important psalm, and it's a powerful psalm, and it was a psalm picked, I think, because of the crisis that Glia is responding to in relation to Ukraine and the war that's going on there. And there's something that can happen for us. Is the first thing is that we look at a crisis like in Ukraine and we just think it's just too big a problem. We see millions of people dispersed. We see millions of people who are having to flee from Ukraine to other countries, whether it be Elgin recently, some people arrived, I saw in the paper, whether it be Scotland or the UK or Germany, as we were hearing about, or elsewhere. And it just seems too out of our control to really make a difference. Everything that we might do feels like a drop in the ocean and it seems overwhelming. And in those moments, we come to Psalm 46 and we're remembered and reminded who God is. God is so infinitely great that he makes the promise that one day wars will cease to the ends of the earth. There will not be one war in the earth. Every bow will be broken. Every spear will be shattered. And even the chariots will be burned with fire because they'll have no purpose for them. In comes God into this great crisis moment, even in our own world history with Russia and Ukraine and whatever it looks like at the moment that Russia haven't had the quick victory they thought they'd have, whether that's God or not. Ultimately, we can look at Psalm 46 and see God is on the throne and he makes a declaration that this war will not be a never-ending war. And not only will this war not be an everlasting war, but a time will come where there will be peace forever. Brought by God, enforced by God, and war will not be allowed again. But on the other side of that, you might think to yourself that because God is so big and God is so vast, he's only really interested in these big things because he's the only one that can deal with these big problems. And in the same psalm, we come and we're told that God is our refuge and strength, our very present help in trouble. Do you know if you had car trouble this evening getting to church, God cared. You know, if you had some little thing in your life this week, an assessment due, a crazy conversation, a need to go and say sorry to someone or to let go of something that someone did to you, do you know God isn't just interested in the big Ukraine wars, he's also interested in you, in every aspect of your life. And as we come to this communion table, I want to give you the encouragement that God is here. And God came in the form of his son into the world because he cares about every aspect of your life. That recognizing that our separation from God was such a crisis in his life, such a crisis for him to see us in our lostness, that he came into this world and gave up his body and poured out his blood in order that we might have a way to draw near to him. And that in this victory is not just an individual victory, but a victory over the whole world. So that he can say with authority at the beginning of John that in him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. God shines into the darkness, even into the chaos of war, or into the chaos of our own days sometimes. God shines in his light, and God's light is never overcome by darkness. You don't switch the darkness on, do you? You switch the light on, because the light always overpowers the darkness. And at this table, we're reminded, God has overcome. His lightness is not pushed back. He pushes back, pushes out our sins, giving us that forgiveness that we need. He pushes out our chaos, bringing the life and the righteousness of Christ, dying on the cross, that our sins might be answered for once and for all. 1 Peter 4, the righteous for the unrighteous. He has given his life so that we might have life to the fullest. This is who we celebrate. Don't come to this table thinking God doesn't care about every detail of your life. Don't come to this table thinking that God doesn't have authority to speak into every aspect of the life. Even world wars, God speaks with authority into, and his light is never overcome. So come to this great, awesome, powerful God, but also come to this intimate Father who invites you through faith to come and be reminded of the power of the death of his body and his blood poured out as a sacrifice once and for all for us. We're encouraged, we're called, we're even commanded to come and be reminded at this table. Let's have the prayer for the bread and the wine.
Father, as we have acknowledged, we have so much. There are so many who have very little. But Lord, we thank you that we are only here by your grace, and that what we have is given by you. Father, help us to cherish the thought that we will be with you one day and that we will be able to see you face to face. As we see the light shine through the windows of this building, there are some corners that are dark where the light does not shine. But Lord, we thank you that your Spirit moves round this room when we worship you, and it lights in each and every one of the corners. As Rab has already said, there are no dark areas that you cannot get to. So, Father, as we reflect on the love that you poured out on us by sending your Son to die on the cross for us, we take this bread, a symbol of his body that was broken, and we take this cup, a symbol of his blood that was shed. And as we eat and as we drink, we do so in remembrance of him. Amen.
Paul tells us to the church in Corinth, I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." We'll take the bread as we receive it. The same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So we receive the cup, we'll hold on to it and take it together as a sign of our unity in Christ. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Let's close our service together in prayer. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this opportunity to come to this table to be reminded of your faithfulness to us. We thank you, Lord, that there is no situation that is beyond your light reaching into the darkness. We think of our own lives, Lord. There's nothing that we could do that can separate us from you, Lord, that through faith we can be forgiven of all the things that we've done to push distance between you and us, all the times we've rejected you, all the times we've walked away from you, Lord. Nothing except unbelief itself will ever hinder us from coming to you. And nothing is so great that you cannot overcome it through your Son, Jesus Christ, on the cross. We thank you too, Lord, that that's not just a personal thing that you've done in our lives, but it's an authority that you have over all creation, Lord. We think of our world at the moment. We think of the persecution of Christians around the world, who the very ones who just to say your name, to profess you as Lord and Savior, can cost them their life. Lord, we think of the chaos at the moment in Afghanistan, Lord, that has many of our nation's DNA written all over it. Lord, how little difference we have made, but what a great difference you make. Lord, we pray that your kingdom would be built in that country. Lord, we think of North Korea and the chaos for COVID arriving and being recognized in that country. Lord, would that be an opportunity to open the doors to Christian charity working in that nation? Lord, we thank you for the many who have stayed in that country, though they may cost them their life in order that they might preach and proclaim the gospel. Lord, as we look at their lives, we realize just what an open opportunity we have in this country to share our faith, Lord. We pray that you would give us a holy boldness to go and share who you are, to share the life that you bring, the light that you bring into our lives and into every situation, Lord. And we pray we go from here with a sense that you've equipped us, that in a small way this bread and wine has sustained us as a representation of the fact that you sustain all things, giving us everything that we need, equipping us in every way to be faithful to what you've called us to do. And now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.